The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Let's go.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who are you with?
Sir Walter Jones.
One more game.
Sir Walter Jones.
The Sir Walter Jones Show. Co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in where we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
Proverbs 18 and 10. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and is safe. Got a question about scriptures? Well, we got the answers. Just ask the elders. It's Theology Thursday, right here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Tell me, who can I run to?
Everybody, hello. Sir Walter Jones Show. I am he. It's Thursday. Theology Thursday. Sit around and talk about the Bible. The B-I-B-L-E. Yeah, that's the book for me. We're going to a short book. Just one chapter, about 25 verses. That's it. And it's over with. Or is it? It's power-packed with information that you need to know about false teachers. How to pray in the Holy Spirit and how to snatch somebody out of the fire, and that wonderful doxology at the end that we all know, now unto him that's able to keep you from falling. Hey Jude. A beautiful song. Just a beautiful song. I love it. I thought it was just so perfect for this here, at least the humming part. The lyrics don't match. Yeah, we're going there today. The Epistle of Jude. And my Facebook friends have joined in already, and they're ready to rock and roll with this here. Take out your pencils, your pens, your paper, your Bible. Go with me here and see if we can make sense of this book and find out, who is Jude? Why did he write such an epistle? And how can we apply this to our lives? Absolutely. Hey, but before I can continue with this, I do have some breaking news that just came in over the wires. Thank you, Marilyn Keeter, who is hired by the Sir Walter Jones Show to report to us about what's going on out there in the streets. Right here in Chicago, unfortunately, there's a special report happened around 2:53 today. If you're listening to us live, today is February the 4th, 2016. There was a news report as a well-being check called from the Chicago Police Department. Upon arriving at 5700 block of South California, that's in the Gage Park area, those of you who live in Chicago, police found seven victims, all stabbed to death. Investigators are still on the scene, and we are awaiting more details. Now, that came in from Ms. Keeter earlier, but then they confirmed the six bodies. They all stabbed to death. One victim was a child between the age of 10 to 12. And the rest of the victims are male and female. And upon arrival, the Chicago Police Department could see a body laying on the floor through the window. And CPD expected to do a full investigation. And usually the preliminary steps is to photograph the entire area. You know, the coroner will come in and look around the scene and take fingerprints and identification purposes and things. And then the scene will then be photographed again after he leaves. They say narcotics could possibly be involved. Usually if a child is involved, domestic is usually a one-on-one or two. So we want to pray for that entire area over there at Gage Park. and the families who have been affected by this. I have found out, I have discovered that by watching the news, that there was a huge heroin addiction in Illinois. I think Illinois, if I'm not mistaken, is the largest in the country as far as heroin addiction. And when you get that type of addiction, here comes the crime. And the murder rate goes up and the gangs get involved because that's how they make their monies. And the pushers, the drug pushers. And it's just a recycled situation, recycled sin. There's nothing new under the sun, as Scripture tells us in Ecclesiastes. We will be fighting this until Jesus comes. So again, pray for those out there who was affected by this. You'll be hearing more, I'm sure, in the next coming moments and the next few days. It'll be news. Our channels will be interrupted. Jude, the author identifies himself as Jude, the brother of James, likely the James who was the brother of our Lord and leader of the Jerusalem church. Okay. Now, Jude 1 identifies the author of the book as Jude, the brother of James, but this likely refers to Jesus' half-brother, as Jesus had a half-brother named James. You have to go to Matthew 13 and 55 to understand that. Now, Jude likely does not identify himself as a brother of Jesus out of humility and reverence for Christ. Okay. The date is consideration in establishing the date of this letter include whether Jude is dependent upon 2 Peter or whether 2 Peter is dependent upon Jude. Or whether both letters have drawn from a third document, which circulated as a warning against false teachers. And since most of Jude has parallels in 2 Peter, okay, some kind of interdependence, you know, possibly is obvious. But if Jude was written before 2 Peter, it may have been as early as A.D. 65. And if it was written after 2 Peter, as many scholars probably assume, and it is canonized in our Bibles accordingly, then it may have been a late A.D. 80. And we're going to reference 2 Peter in this particular study because it's so very important. But let's talk about the background of the book of Jude. Jude appears urgent in his purpose to warn an unknown community of Christians against false teachers, as in 2 Peter. These would be leaders. These would be leaders are central. You have to go to verse 4 and 16 and 18. You'll see in a minute. They pervert the truth and they are destined for divine judgment. They are called dreamers in verse 8, perhaps given to, you know, dreams and visions and dreams or what have you. And they are clouds without water. Just so poetic there in verse 12. And they are exposed as having not the spirit. The last reference hints that the false teachers represented themselves as those who did have the spirit. Okay. Matthew 7 and 22. They may also be forerunners of Gnostic heretics in the second century who claimed spirituality. Okay, the Gnostics, y'all. We did a study on the Gnostics before. That's Gnostic. There it is. Okay, one of these days I'm gonna get it right. I need a reader. So it seemed to be a short read today, but it's going to be intense because we're going to do a lot of cross referencing. Okay. There are, as far as the Gnostics is concerned, there is a Gnostic gospel, and the definition of the word, of course, is about as easy to nail down as a flopping fish. It's derived from the Greek word gnosis, which means to know. In the case of Gnosticism, what is known has shifted over the thousands of years since Gnosticism first they reared its head during the deformation and solidification of the early churches. Okay. So basically, the Gnostic believes in acquiring special mythical, mystical knowledge as the means for salvation. And I know some people today who does that. According to Gnostic beliefs, there is a great God that is good and perfect, but impersonal and unknowable. The creator of the universe was actually a lesser deity, a cheap knockoff of the true God, who wanted to create a flawless material universe, but botched the job. Yeah, that's them. That's them Gnostics. Let's see here. The letter Jude begins and ends with an affirmation of God's gracious action on behalf of believers, stressing divine preservation. However, Christians themselves should earnestly contend for the faith. We need to spend an entire show on that. I think we did a show called Contend for the Faith. Their responsibilities are further developed in, let's see, we'll go, you'll see it at the end of around verse 20 to 23 by a series of practical exhortations, okay? Now, the balance of the lesser exposes, especially in the light of the Old Testament analogies, the secret presence of false teachers within the community who seek to overflow or overthrow the faith of God's people. And this is that was the background. This is we spoke of the contents of this short book. And again, we're going to do some references, cross reference. All right. I think I have my reader here. I'm going to flip some pages in the King James. She's going to hit the send button on her her little bot over there. And she's going to read out of NLT as I would like. Okay. The real NLT this time, please. Not that phony stuff you had us, you know, last week. You want me to drink the spoon too?
On the air.
Everything on the air.
Yes, you do.
They could probably smell my cologne on his air because I do. I expose everything on the air.
You have on cologne?
Right. All right. Let's start with verse 1, please. Chapter 1, y'all.
Chapter 1.
Because there ain't but one. All right.
This letter is from Jude, mm-hmm. a slave of Jesus Christ and a brother of James. I am writing to all who have been called by God the Father, who loves you and keeps you safe in the care of Jesus Christ.
Preserved in Jesus Christ and called.
May God give you more and more mercy.
Mercy.
Peace. And love.
Mercy unto you and peace and love be multiplied. And you hear that in church when you walk in, mm-hmm. when doing testimony service. Peace be unto the saints.
Peace be multiplied.
All right. Yes. And this is, now he mentioned sanctified in verse 1. Mm-hmm. It refers to God's special action in setting apart believers for himself. However, the proper reading here may be beloved. In either case, the divine initiative is apparent, as it is in the preceding word, called. Mm. Called. Okay. All right. For you nerds out there, you needed to know that. I have about three nerds out there. I'm not going to call their names, but I might at the end of the show. You know who you are. Go to verse 3, please.
Dear friends.
Beloved.
I had been eagerly planning to write to you about the salvation we all share.
So Jude was writing a letter mm-hmm. about salvation mm-hmm. to a people.
Yes.
And he stopped writing. Mm. That's what's happening here. Mm-mm. Okay, read it again. Yes.
Dear friends, mm-hmm. I had been eagerly planning to write to you about the salvation.
No, you said planning?
Yes.
All right. Because King James says, beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you, of the common salvation, okay? Mm-hmm. He had planned on doing it.
Right.
And you have a King James language can be very tricky sometimes. Mm-hmm. It's that Shakespearean Old English.
Right.
It's poetic.
Yes.
But the people back then, they understood it. We today don't really understand. That's why we need so much interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Continue with that.
But now I find that I must write about something else.
Oh, there it is.
Urging you to defend the faith
mm-hmm.
that God has entrusted once for all time to his holy people.
I was watching the preachers of Atlanta last night.
Shame on you.
I know. I repented on air on the Facebook.
Oh, did you?
Mm-hmm. They forgave me.
Okay.
And I watched it, and right away I wanted to make a video about it. And I read this in verse 3, and I see why he did. He was getting ready to write about something as simple as salvation, and mm-hmm. he had to stop and write about something else.
Mm-hmm.
I'm watching this Preachers of Atlanta, and I stopped in my track and says, I got to talk about something else.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was just so horrific to see those who were representing Christianity
yeah.
act a fool
yeah.
on television. Mm-hmm. All right? Now, if this Oxygen, that's the name of the network.
Yes.
Now, if they come to you and say, we want to do a show on you, I need you to tell them no.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Okay.
Please tell them no. Do not let Oxygen do nothing for you.
Right.
Because they're going to make a monkey out of you.
Yeah.
Right? Because a lot of these reality shows are both lightly scripted
mm-hmm.
and heavily scripted.
Mm.
They call it a reality show. But trust me, those producers are scripting. They're telling them to be as...
Yep.
Flamboyant and mm-hmm. be as combative as possible.
Yeah.
That brings the ratings.
Yes, it does.
I was watching the Leandra Johnson, mm-hmm. Her segments.
Mm-hmm.
We had her on the show.
Yes.
And y'all saw my little video I did on her.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Where I said it was not her fault for okay. her acting the way she is.
Right.
I blame the people who continue to support her
mm-hmm.
in this mess she does on Periscope. Okay. But there she was in the street, like we all should be, you know, reaching out to the needy.
Mm-hmm.
Well, not so much the poor, but, well, she was reaching out to prostitutes and crackheads and mm-hmm. what have you. And she was passing out condoms and cigarettes. And there was a big fight on Facebook about it. Okay, well, I did the video, so I'm not going to go further than that.
Mm-hmm.
So that wasn't my issue. My issue was how she was treating her husband. In front of us. The husband, apparently, now the fact that I even know this information really makes me want to vomit, too. Remember when Mary had their little reality show?
Yes.
They still have it?
Yeah.
Okay, and what's the sister? Not the sister who have her own little CD, but the other sister.
Wait, it's Erica and it's Tina.
Tina started going crazy because her husband was cheating on her.
Right.
All right. And yelling and screaming at her, mm-hmm. him at mm-hmm. In the kitchen or something like that. Mm-hmm. Just going off. And mm-hmm. we all seeing her private matters.
Yeah.
Blasted out there on television.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. For ratings.
Mm-hmm.
And then she eventually repented and regretted doing that.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now here comes Preachers of Atlanta. All right. And then here's Johnson putting a finger in this boy's face about some girl he got pregnant and wanting him to do a test. What do you call that test? Yeah, paternity. Is something like
mm-hmm,
that?
Paternity.
And like, okay, I'm all right. And, you know, he's trying to be nice with her. But when he tries to talk to her, she starts applauding in coy to be. You know, like sarcastic, like,
really?
And I'm watching this, and I said, and I'm having this vision of her taking a knife and chopping his private parts off.
Okay.
She was emaciated. Is that the word?
Emasculating.
Yeah.
Right. That's good. Yeah.
You know, I'll be testing y'all on these when I ask
you.
These
are you really testing us?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I'll be testing y'all.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, she emasculated him.
Mm-hmm.
Right there, and then. She walked out. He says, "Mom, we're not finished talking." He was very calm. "I'm not finished talking. Come on now. How are you going to help me?" And you going to, so she walked. I don't want to hear it. And she got in the car. And then it caused him to rise up a little bit
mm-hmm.
in anger. And then she gets in her car and she starts driving the, he's standing in front of the car, and some other people show up, try to stop him and her from arguing, and she starts to pull off and run them both over, all of them over. It was just sad. Here's a preacher,
what?
Pastor Leandra Johnson, driving off, almost running everybody over. And I'm saying to myself, this is
ridiculous.
Ridiculous. And this is putting God to shame.
It is.
Okay. And so that's what verse 3 said to me. Let me stop what I was doing.
Mm-hmm.
Let me address the situation.
So sad.
Defend the faith.
Mm-hmm.
But not on oxygen. You don't know how to.
Right.
Okay, that video's still coming, y'all. I'm still going to make one. I go to verse 4. I spent a lot of time on that, but I just needed to.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 4, please.
I say this because some ungodly people have wormed their way into your churches.
There it is.
Mm-mm-mm.
They wormed their way.
Mm-hmm.
Who ordained her to be a pastor?
Right.
You see what I'm saying? We need to find out.
Mm-hmm.
Did she self-choose herself?
Right.
Because there are a lot of people out there saying, I'm Dr. So-and-so.
Right.
Well, who make you? And did you go and pay $25 on Google for that? Okay. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Mm-mm. Saying that God's marvelous grace allows us to live immoral lives.
That's what she's saying. She's defending everything she does. She says, I'm a different woman than a pastor than what y'all. I'm unorthodox. I'm untraditional. Uh-huh. What is it?
The condemnation of such people was recorded long ago.
Yeah.
For they have denied our only master and Lord, Jesus Christ.
Those type of people are going to stand before Christ and say, look at all the people I got saved.
Mm.
Okay. And they did. They're people who came to the Lord for people like that who act a fool. God's going to say, all right, thanks. All right. But I don't know you.
Mm, right.
Depart. I've never met you. Who are you again?
Mm.
Uh-huh.
So I want to remind you.
This is 5.
This is verse 5.
Uh-huh. This is past judgment of false teachers. Uh-huh.
So I want to remind you.
Put you in remembrance.
Though you already know these things, that Jesus first rescued the nation of Israel from Egypt.
Yeah.
But later he destroyed those who did not remain faithful.
Yeah. He later he rescued and then destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
They came out of Egypt, went into the wilderness. Moses went away, went on a vacation for about 40 days.
Mm-hmm.
Went up on the mountain.
Vacation.
Mm-hmm. Because he was gone so long, they said, you know what? We out here to die. Hey, you got some gold on? You got gold? Yeah. Yeah. Aaron, why don't you, you know, kind of burn that gold a little bit, make us an idol so we can worship it. Because we got to worship something.
Mm-hmm.
That's what's going on here in verse 5.
Mm-hmm.
What's it again?
Verse 5 again, so I want to remind you, though you already know these things.
Yeah, you already know.
That Jesus first rescued the nation of Israel from Egypt.
Jesus did it. You saw that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because Jesus was always there. Yes. He was always there.
Mm.
Okay.
But later he destroyed those who did not remain faithful.
And then later on, he says, because you can't, I love you, but you can't remain faithful, I got to get rid of you.
Mm-hmm.
All right, 6.
And I remind you of the angels who did not stay within the limits of authority God gave them.
The limits of authority that who gave them?
God gave
them. Okay, and the angels which kept not their first estate, is what King James is saying, but left their inhabitants. Mm-hmm. He has reserved an everlasting, let's see, chains. Mm-hmm. Okay, what's your say?
And I remind you of the angels who did not stay within the limits of authority God gave them, but left the place where they belonged.
Right.
God has kept them securely chained in prisons of darkness, waiting for the great day of judgment.
Yeah. You're like, what? Who are these angels?
Mm-hmm.
And what the state were they before, and where are they chained?
Right.
Here's where we have to do some cross references.
Okay.
Okay. Let's see. Do I want you to finish that? Go to 7. What does it say?
And don't forget Sodom and Gomorrah and their neighboring towns, which were filled with immorality and every kind of sexual perversion.
Yeah.
Those cities were destroyed by fire.
Okay.
And serve as a warning of the eternal fire of God's judgment.
Man. So 6, you'll have to go to 2 Peter. Chapter 2, to see what's going on here. Chapter 2 and go to verse 4, if you can, please.
2 Peter 2 and 4?
Yeah. This is the destruction of false teachers, okay? Matter of fact, can you go to chapter 2, verse 1?
Alrighty. But there were also false prophets in Israel, just as there will be false teachers among you. They will cleverly teach destructive heresies and even deny the master who bought them. In this way, they will bring sudden destruction on themselves.
Apostasy. Yeah.
Many will follow their evil teaching and shameful immorality. And because of these teachers, the way of truth will be slandered.
Man, because of these teachers. These are teachers. I just saw that last night on the preachers of everything.
Yeah.
Okay. What did it say?
In their greed, they will make up clever lies to get a hold of your money.
Yeah.
But God condemned them long ago, and their destruction will not be delayed.
Prosperity preachers. They do whatever they can to get your money. They're going to sell oils on television. They're going to scream on your TV. All right. And then what they're going to do, they're going to use your language. Tell you, okay, do you feel anything now? Sensationalism.
Yeah.
They know your language. They know your culture. And they will win you over every time. A politician will come to your church and use Christian words because he know that's what gets them every time. As soon as President Obama came to the funeral of that the brother last year who was shot.
Yeah.
As soon as he starts singing a hymn. That entire place went up. That's the language.
Yep.
Yeah. Go to 4, please. Verse 4 is in reference to what Jude 6 is saying here.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
For God did not spare even the angels who sinned.
Okay. These are the angels that Jude 6 is mentioning here. He didn't spare them.
He threw them into hell.
Oh, that's where they are.
In gloomy pits of darkness, where they are being held until the day of judgment.
Yep, throw them in the hell. And when they're going to be there until God decides to judge them. And then what?
And God did not spare the ancient world.
No.
Except for Noah and the seven others in his family.
Oh, I see.
Noah warned the world of God's righteous judgment.
Okay, well then we got to figure out who are these angels who were at a place before, then they left that place. Well, you got to go to Genesis. You got to go all the way. See, the Bible interprets itself. Line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. Actually, if you go to Genesis 5, as we enter into this break here, that's what we're going to start at when we come out of this break. Let's go to Genesis chapter 5. Do some cross references, come back and see what is it that Jude 6 were talking about, and why did he bring up these so-called angels, who were they, and what did God do to them, and how does it apply to us today? Yeah, absolutely. That's what we're going to do.
Good.
Yeah. Listen, it's 4:30 in the p.m. in Chicagoland, y'all. It's a little cold outside because it's winter, but we're going to warm up soon because some rat saw its shadow, or it didn't see its shadow. I can't remember. I think I want to hear, since it's 4:30, the great Richard Smallwood. If you want to hear all of Richard Smallwood's music, and we did a dedication to him and his music, you have to go to the Richard Smallwood Effect on Spreaker.com. But this one here is called Total Praise. It is probably the best song he had ever written. And all choirs in the world sing this song here. Richard Smallwood with Vision, Adoration, live in Atlanta, y'all, 1996. Enjoy this little ditty as we come back. Total Praise. So Walter Jones Show.
No, did you miss part of today's show? Well, just head to Spreaker.com. That is Spreaker, Spreaker.com, and type in the Sir Walter Jones Show to get today's episode and past ones.
Robert Smalls, during the American Civil War, became a ship's pilot, sea captain, and after, a politician. His example helped convince President Lincoln to accept African-American soldiers in the U.S. Army. He won an election to the South Carolina State Legislature and the United States House of Representatives. He was the longest-serving African-American member of Congress until the late 20th century. This is Kenyatta Humphrey for the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Total praise, everybody. Richard Smallwood, 1996, live in the great city called Atlanta. Shout out to my brother Larry. I'm sorry, David.
David.
Larry's in Indiana. David's in Atlanta. Michael's in Miami. I got folk all over the place. So, David, yeah, shout out to you, David, and my son, Walter Jones Jr., Prince. Prince Walter, by the way. He's in Atlanta. That's my boy there. Love him dearly. Okay, we were reading out of, matter of fact, let's go to Facebook because they chiming in already. I don't want to forget y'all. Art Lewis, I'll start from the bottom. Did I say that? Donald Trump tried to language the language of the political Christian thing and failed horrendously. He sure did.
He sure did.
He was trying to read out of
2 Corinthians.
And he should have went to I, John. still, humans can be so arrogant and self-serving. Christ doesn't need an antics to reveal himself.
Our antics.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, our antics. Yeah. I have to learn how to slow it down when I read that. Mm-hmm. Let's see what else. Nelly says, right, these shows are a tool to destroy what's left of Christian values. It really is. Really, really is. Let's see. Brony Scott, usually the first one that chimes in on Thursdays. She says, Jude, a.k.a. Judas, was one of the brothers of Jesus. He was in the upper room, with the 120 when the Holy Ghost came on the day of Pentecost. However, I always wondered, why did Jesus give John charge to take care of his mother instead of one of his biological brothers? Well, technically not biological, she's saying. Okay. Good question. Let's see. She also asked, and just think that people have taken pray in the Holy Ghost to mean pray while speaking in tongues. And Art says, yep, see what reading incomprehension will get you. But then I think it was, I think I saw Angela Garrett said, it's a short book, but I love it, especially the doxology. Please expound on deflecting the false teachers and how to pray. Many people are misguided. I hate the like button there too. All right, we'll see if we can get to that when we get to that in scripture.
What?
Yep, I said it. I did say that. And Paul Rodgers says, total praise is modern masterpiece. Yes, it is. Even marching bands are playing that at football stadiums across the country. Just an amazing piece of work. I said it about Alvin C. Carter, too, who just walked in. He's an amazing piece of work.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Yeah, wasn't a compliment.
Peace.
Well, I took it as one.
See, you always take us up. He always takes us up out of context.
Right. Yeah. Peace be still over there.
Yeah, be still. Okay, go to Genesis, please. Go to Genesis chapter 5. We're trying to figure out, those of you who just joined us, about who is these angels in Jude 6. It says, and the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness until the judgment of the great day. So we had to reference 2 Peter chapter 2. And I think it was 4 that you read, I think I told you. In fact, let me go there. Mm-hmm. Just for those of you who just joined in, you started at 1, but you said, Peter said, for if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved until judgment, spared not the old world, but saved Noah and the eighth person. The eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly. Okay, that's what Peter says. They're still talking about these angels. They're chained. But let's go to the backstory of this whole thing. You have to go to chapter 5 in Genesis. What does it say?
Verse 1.
Yeah.
This is the written account of the descendants of Adam.
Uh-huh.
When God created human beings,
yeah,
he made them to be like himself.
Right.
He created the male and
male
female.
And female. He created them both because they both had a plan sexually. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You had a positive and a negative. One had a protruding part. The other one had a cave.
Wow.
And they both fit,
wow,
like the battery and to the bipoles. That's what bipolar means. Okay? Plus in the dash.
Look at Al.
I'm trying to help y'all understand the order of God.
I think I just learned
okay
something.
Two plus poles can't come together
positive,
except
negative.
It be an explosion. All right?
You put opposites.
Yes.
Attack.
They attack. All right? Okay.
They don't attract.
Didn't they attack? All right. I'm just trying to help y'all out here.
Well, same attack. Same poles attack.
There. All right. Have you ever taken, remember we used to play with magnets?
Yep.
We put one on the table, another one up under.
And they're going to automatically turn.
Yeah, they
to
turn.
Many poles.
Yep.
The negatives are going to seek out the positive.
That's
positive
it.
Seek out the negative.
That's
you
exactly
actually make
it.
Them walk around in a circle.
Mm-hmm. There it is. And that's what two men do when they come together.
Go around a circle.
You see what I'm saying?
Where you trying to go? 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 Where you trying to go?
That don't fit in there.
Yeah,
that don't belong in there.
Keep your pole.
That's an X. That's
exit
an X.
Only.
That's exit. Okay. I'm just trying to be as decent
as
clear and decent as possible. Okay.
A positive sign if you angle it a little bit looks like an X.
Yeah, it does. It sure do.
Wow.
If your glasses are foggy,
it's perpendicular. Neither way.
Yeah. Yeah. It is. Yep. Start reading, please.
I will. He created the male and female.
Yeah, he did.
And he blessed them and called them human.
Uh-huh.
When Adam was 130 years old,
yeah,
He became the father of a son who was just like him.
Who's that?
In his very image.
Uh-huh.
He named his son Seth.
Seth.
After the birth of Seth,
yeah.
Adam lived another 800 years, and he had other sons and daughters.
Okay, you can stop there. That's Seth. Then you go to verse 24, and what does it say?
All right, verse 24.
Now go to 21.
When Enoch was 65 years old.
Okay, Enoch is the great-great-great-great-grandson.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
He became the father of Methuselah.
Yeah, old dude.
After the birth of Methuselah,
uh-huh.
Enoch lived in close fellowship with God for another 300 years.
It never said he spoke a word. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
And he had other sons and daughters.
That's all it's saying about him. And then what?
Enoch lived 365 years,
uh-huh.
walking in close fellowship with God.
Yep.
Then one day,
what happened?
He disappeared.
Yep.
Because God took him.
God took him. That's it. That's all we know about Enoch. Close the book and we're done. Okay?
Mm-hmm. What about the further reference mm-hmm. of his book?
Mm-hmm. Well, we're going there.
Okay.
When teachers come late.
I'm just asking questions.
No, go ahead.
Man. I ain't go ahead. I just ask a question.
Okay, now go to chapter 6, please.
Chapter 6 of Genesis?
Yes, this is the backstory of these angels. Okay.
Which verse?
1.
Okay. Then the people began to multiply on the earth,
mm-hmm.
and daughters were born to them. The sons of God saw the beautiful women, and they took any they wanted as their wives.
Sons of God. So we have to be careful how to define sons of God, because the Bible used sons of God to refer to the children of Israel as well as the angels in heaven.
Mm.
Because look at the book of Job when the Bible says, and the sons of God met with God.
Mm-hmm.
And then Satan showed up.
Yep.
All right. So that wasn't people, sons of God. Those were the angels, the angelic beings. Okay. And what does it say?
Then the Lord said,
what?
My spirit would not put up with humans
I ain't
for
put
such
up with
a
this.
Long time.
Okay.
Uh-huh. For they are only mortal flesh.
Mm-hmm.
In the future, their normal lifespan will be no more than 120 years.
Yes. Because he will let people live 1,000 years almost. Uh-huh.
In those days, and for some time after, giant Nephilites
lived on
the earth.
That's them giants, and I believe possibly that Goliath might have came from that little them folk there. Uh huh.
Mm. And there's still some
Philistines,
around, but they medically call it a disease mm-hmm. called giantism.
They do call it that. They sure do. Uh-huh.
For whenever the sons of God had intercourse with women,
okay, these angels, we don't know how it happened. We can't explain it. But they had sex with these women on earth. Uh-huh.
They gave birth to children who became the heroes and famous warriors of ancient times.
I believe those are Philistines and the enemies of Israel.
Wow.
Yes. Uh-huh.
The Lord observed the extent of human wickedness on the earth.
Yeah.
And he saw that everything they thought or imagined was consistently and totally
nasty.
Evil.
Evil, evil, evil. And so you're trying to figure out where these angels come from? Well, remember when the Bible talked about how Jesus, before he ascended, he first descended into the lower parts of the earth?
Mm-hmm,
let's go to Ephesians chapter 4, please, and see if we can find that to make sense of this. Again, the Bible interprets itself. You don't have to ask a million questions to the prophet that comes to town once every year.
Ephesians 4 and 1.
mm-hmm.
Therefore, I, a prisoner for serving the Lord.
I got to go further than that. Let me get to my Ephesus to see if I could catch up with you. Okay. All right. So if we do 4, let's do 4 and 7.
Verse 7?
Yeah.
However, he has given each one of us a special gift through the generosity of Christ.
Christ is this. He's given us gifts. Uh-huh.
That is why the scriptures say.
What did you say?
When he ascended to the heights.
Mm-hmm.
He led a crowd of captives and gave gifts to his people.
Hmm. KJV says he led captivity.
Yes, that's in Psalm 68:18 for those of you who are trying to reference that. Because when it says, and did you not know what the scripture says? Well, here's what it says. All right. Okay, say it again.
When he ascended to the heights, he
yeah.
led a crowd of captives and gave gifts to his people.
He led a crowd of captives. When Christ died on the cross, dead people start popping up. Everywhere.
Yeah, because he took control of death.
Mm-hmm. That's right. And these were the Old Testament saints who died prior to Christ coming on the earth. Because You know, they had to be somewhere. These were the ones who were with laying on the bosom of Abraham. Remember the story of the rich ruler,
rich
and Lazarus. Okay, and the rich the Lazarus woke up in the was laying in the bosom of Abraham, and the rich guy was burning.
He said, "Give me some water.
I need some water.
Please just some fingertips."
Fingertips. Maybe that's what Stephen wanted to get that.
Yeah,
Stephen fingertip.
Yeah, that's possible. Mm-hmm. Give me a little bit.
Yeah. Okay, and there was a great ghost separating them. And this was the original paradise. Before Christ came, those people went somewhere, the good people. They went there, in the lower parts of the earth. So it's right here. Christ then, when he came out of the earth, he led what?
Captivity captive.
Uh-huh. What did it say?
Verse 9.
Yeah.
Notice that it says he ascended.
Right.
This clearly means that Christ also descended to our lowly world.
Yes. Now, that is there a question mark right there?
No.
Okay. King James got a question mark. So, that's why I say you
because
have
it was a rhetorical question.
Yeah.
Didn't you know he went to the lower world?
Mm-hmm. Because
it's a conversation.
There you go.
I understand that Paul is having a conversation. This is written in declarative statements.
Mm-hmm.
Paul is writing in a rhetorical, conversational style.
Yes. And if you didn't know that, you would have questioned verse 9 if you're reading in King James. This is why I always reference the two, if sometimes three different interpretations so that we can get a full understanding. Because somebody would have disagreed with NLT because they didn't put the question mark there.
Some still do.
Absolutely.
But if you have, as someone said on the thread, reading comprehension skills,
yeah,
you would look at the question mark within context.
That's it.
Because you can present a rhetorical question.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And
rhetoric is a science.
It is.
It's a liberal art and science. It was not taught anymore.
No, it's not. No.
We think sarcasm is rhetoric. We mistake sarcasm
we do.
For rhetoric. We do.
That's why we get texts from our friends and we get upset with them because we don't know how to read the text because we don't know the spirit of how the text came across because we don't know punctuation.
We don't use
punctuation.
Nope.
So you thinking
can't spell and can't mark.
Mm-hmm. Okay, go for it.
Verse 10.
Uh-huh.
And the same one who descended is the one who ascended higher than all the heavens, so that he might fill the entire universe with himself.
So when he come out of the grave, all those dead people that was walking, the dead men walking, he took all of them and they went into the new paradise. He transferred paradise from the lower parts into heaven. That's where they are right now. And then in walked verse 11, which is a very popular and very familiar scripture here. What does it say?
Now, these are the gifts Christ gave to the church.
He gave some of them. What?
Not the kingdom.
Right.
I'm sorry.
The apostles.
Yes.
The prophets.
Mm-hmm.
The evangelists.
Right.
And the pastors and teachers.
These are gifts that he gave to man. These people are the gifts.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
Their responsibility is to equip God's people.
Wait. You mean to say these people are the gifts?
Mm-hmm.
Or he gave gifts to these people?
Uh-oh. Ooh-wee. You about to go there, man. You have to read it again.
Now, these are the gifts Christ gave to the church.
What?
The apostles.
You see what I'm saying? These people were the gifts. They were not given the gift, although they were given a gift.
Right.
Because to be a teacher, pastor, these are gifts, okay? Mm-hmm. But they are a gift for us.
Yeah.
And some were given, not everybody. That's what
so
King
can
James
one be
said.
All? Because it says, and he gave some.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, keep going.
Mm. NLT doesn't have some.
Right.
That's fine.
That's why I challenge you sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. Translation.
That's I'm telling you, we keep going back there.
And this, and I say that because this ideology of I am a gift to the church, this egoism, which is why you have these reality shows today, is because they read it this way and say, treat me as a gift.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, treat me. Mm-hmm. Treat me by paying my bills, paying my mortgage. Treat me by letting me live better than you on your bank account. Because I am a gift.
Yeah.
So I have to challenge it that way.
But God sent these men and women to us as gifts.
Men and women?
You can't believe it.
Women?
Women's
too? No.
I can't deal with you. Nope.
Well, I did.
Okay, continue.
The prophets, the evangelists.
Yeah, ain't no S's.
And the pastors and teachers.
I don't get no E's.
No, I can't do this with you.
The men.
Oh, my goodness. Abba's Nana just sent me, she's, I hope this is not true.
What?
Maurice White died.
Oh, I'm not surprised.
I just tagged you guys in.
You did?
I saw the tag, yes.
Isn't that,
after yesterday, so you was flawed in the prophetic yesterday. Yes. Even twice, because I called you with the other show.
Sure did.
So they must have known he was about to make his transition, because he had been battling,
right.
Alzheimer's, not Alzheimer's, but Parkinson's.
Parkinson's.
Yeah.
Oh, he did?
Oh, my. I had no idea.
That's why he stopped touring.
Sure. I had no idea when I prepared that show yesterday.
What time?
Go to Spreaker.
You a gift.
Boy, I tell you.
You a gift. Yeah, I'm you a prophet.
That means I got to pay a higher fee.
No.
This is true.
The Lord has given me the gift of teaching. I will say that. Hey, I what's your gift? Because I know teaching is definitely it.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I believe my gifts, based upon this list, prophet and teacher. Mm-hmm. Some say pastor because I'm so concerned, but mm-hmm. I know evangelism is not it.
No, not me.
Because I don't have that passion to go out and argue.
No.
Now, I would say that about you because you are such an apologist.
What? You talking about what?
Evangelist. Because you're such an apologist. I'm not an apologist. I can't argue the word with you.
Sure.
I can discuss it, but I can't argue with you to make you believe it, because that takes a gift to compel you.
Yeah.
I can teach you after you believe. And God can use me with the word of knowledge, because I can deal with, he can give it to me to give you what to say when you won't talk about it.
Right.
To confirm that God has been dealing with you.
But, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's good stuff.
Now, others have told me I have an apostolic anointing. I'm like, because you seem to go and set things in order and then walk away. Yeah. I said, no, they pushed me out. They take it over. Oh, thank you. I don't need your help no more.
Right. Ooh, my
but
goodness.
I don't claim nothing but being me.
Yeah.
I just want to be God's man.
That's
whatever,
all I want
to
be.
Whatever he needs me to be at that time, from pushing a broom to playing an organ.
Yes.
I just want to be anointed when I do
That's all I want to be.
Keep the title. Give me the anointing.
Yeah, you can keep it. You can keep it. Oh, you can hold on to it.
I take offering, though.
Yeah, I will take that. That's for sure. Okay. And so it says, what are their positions? These are for the church would do what now?
Their responsibility.
Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. Uh-huh. This will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith.
Okay, this is going to continue. So the God didn't get rid of this.
No.
He just said it. It's going to continue until when? We're coming to the unity of our faith?
Uh-huh.
So we haven't done that yet.
So to say the apostles is in the Old Testament or prophets in the Old Testament.
They saying that today that the apostles and the prophets
are done with.
We don't need them anymore. God got rid of them.
I disagree.
But we just read here.
Right.
He says this will continue. How long?
What? He was raised by one.
I sure was. What is it?
This will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ.
And we haven't done that yet. I'm sorry.
You need a prophet sometimes.
I'm sorry.
To come and set things in order sometimes so you can measure up to the full and complete standard.
Mm-hmm. That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro.
Ain't no immature babies.
Caring about with every wind
and
of doctrine.
New teaching and doctrine. Oh, my. See, look at where we at. Well, look where we at.
Whew. Okay. Okay, now you have to go to 1 Peter.
Creatures of Atlanta.
3. we just got to doing that, man. We just got through with that. 1 Peter 3 and 18 to further prove what we just read is what we're trying to interpret it as. What does it say?
Christ suffered for our sins once for all time.
One time.
He never sinned.
Yeah.
But he died for sinners to bring you safely home to God.
Mm.
He suffered physical death, but he was raised to life in the spirit.
I see. Uh-huh. Continue.
So he went and preached to the spirits in prison.
Okay, these spirits are not people. Okay, the King James says, spirits of prison. Okay, sometimes y'all think these are souls, but no, these spirits, because the Bible does not refer to us as spirits. He referred to us as souls when we're talking to us, although we have a spirit.
So you're telling me I'm supposed to be down in Cook County preaching?
No. No, you don't.
Oh.
Stop. Okay.
I'm asking legitimate questions.
Mm-hmm. What did it say?
Those who disobeyed God long ago.
Long ago, okay.
When God waited patiently while Noah was building his boat.
Mm. Uh-huh.
Only 8 people were saved from drowning in that terrible flood.
Mm. Yeah. So to help y'all understand what she's reading here is this. Christ died. He went to the lower parts of the earth and started preaching to these falling angels who he chained up because they were part of Genesis chapter 6.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't preach to them salvation. He proclaimed to them
authority.
That's exactly it. Because they can never be saved.
Mm-hmm.
Ever. Because they're not made like men.
No.
They have no choice in the matter.
Right.
Okay. He gave us choices, but when he made the angels, he says, this is my choice. You either going to be this or that's it. Because some of us can be turned into that type of angel situation because he says there's only one sin that I will never forgive.
And that's that blasphemy.
Yes, of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. He said, I can't forgive that one. So you just like Lucifer in that case. You could say, I'm sorry all you want to.
Yep.
He says, well, once you come into the knowledge of it, that we did the Hebrews. Yeah, you come to the knowledge of the truth and you have tasted of it as Hebrews chapter 6, I think it is.
My God.
Yeah, he says, once you taste of it, I can't forgive you. I mean, you, how dare you come up in here and do this stuff? Knowing that this is real and true and good, and then you go out there and make me look like a fool.
My God.
Okay, so where are you?
That's the end of verse 20.
Okay, then, okay, let's go back to Jude then and read verse 6 again, and it all should make sense. Verse 6.
And I remind you of the angels who did not stay within the limits of authority God mm-hmm. gave them,
mm-hmm.
but left the place where they belonged.
Yes.
God has kept them securely chained in prisons of darkness,
mm-hmm.
waiting for the great day of judgment.
Okay. And then we went all the way around the corner just to take you back here. And then 7 says one again.
And don't forget Sodom and Gomorrah.
Don't forget them.
And their neighboring towns,
mm-hmm.
which were filled with immorality and every kind of sexual perversion.
Notice that he says, and neighboring towns.
Yeah.
We always only bring up Sodom and Gomorrah. That yeah. whole territory.
The whole area was messed up.
Just messed up.
Yeah.
That's the United States. I call it the United States of Sodom and Gomorrah. That's what we have turned into in our neighboring.
Illinois is the only holy state, huh?
Yeah, the only one, because I'm here.
Yeah.
Except God. What was the challenge between God and...
Give me 10. Can I find 10? Oh, I want 50. Give me 50.
Give me 50.
Okay, God, I can't find 50. What about 40? 40. No, okay, give me 30. Okay, God. Oh, no, God, I can't get 30. How about 10? 10? Man, I only got 3. Get rid of them. I only got 3. And that includes me.
Yep. That's it, Doc. That's a perfect example. Okay, what does it say?
Those cities were destroyed by fire mm-hmm. and serve as a warning of the eternal fire of God's judgment.
Ooh-wee. That was the end of what? 7?
Yep. That is correct.
Okay, Facebook is chiming in. Uh-oh, Halliburton.
This means war.
Jerita Halliburton. Oh, boy, we love when she comes around.
Woo.
Yeah, she says, the false brethren have no fear of God, and they have no sense of shame. Their speech and behavior always identifies them as fakes. Woo, that's so true.
Woo.
Just let a fool talk just for about 5 minutes. You know. She says, they can't do right to save their lives. These phonies learn the religious lingo, mannerisms, customs, traditions, and observations of our sacraments. They are all very great actors. They fool a lot of new and old saints who do not study the scriptures to discern
mm-hmm.
good from evil and right from wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my goodness. And that's what atheists do. They study your yeah. Bible just to make you look like a fool.
To mount evidence against you.
Yep. That's exactly it.
They don't study it right. They just gather evidence.
That's
it.
Yeah.
Because evidence is not necessarily factual. It's just information that they yep. can use against you. Mm-hmm. But don't say that part.
Yeah.
If you ever pay close attention to testimony, a lawyer will
yes.
cut you off
yes,
before
sir.
You say what's good for you.
Yes, sir.
Yep. I didn't show that.
Nope.
I'm done with that's yep. enough with this one. I'm done with this one.
I object. Yes.
Yes.
That's good. Yeah, he's leading.
Yeah, you're leading the witness, y'all.
Yeah. Good stuff, man. Hey, yes, y'all. Sir. Hey, it's 5 o'clock in the p.m. in Chicagoland area. Got one more hour to go. Maybe less because, you know, Jude only got a couple more verses. We got a phone caller coming in, hopefully in another minute or two. the great.
That's what this is.
Shamika Wilson. Catch up. Yeah, I know.
Must.
Hey, man, there's a method to my madness.
Oh, yeah, good.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. I want to hear some more Richard Smallwood. It's a Richard Smallwood night, y'all. Here's a song that goes all the way back to 1984. It's called He Won't Leave You.
Oh, great song.
Great song. Trust me, all these false teachers y'all reading about right now, God says, I'll never leave you, nor forsake you. So, Walter Jones Show.
Oh, no. Did you miss part of today's show? Well, just head to Spreaker.com. That is Spreaker, Spreaker.com, and type in the Sir Walter Jones Show to get today's episode and past ones. So do it now.
Today's legend is Pulitzer Prize winner John H. White, one of the first black photographers to work at an American daily newspaper. His career spans over 45 years, with 30 of those teaching within the photojournalism department at Columbia College in Chicago. He says his greatest joy is being the eyes for the people of Chicago on a daily basis and sharing what he sees and feels through the lens of his camera. This is Demetria Brand Triplett for the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Show is paid program and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
You all say, yeah.
Speak, Lord.
Speak to me.
Speak, Lord.
Oh, speak, Lord.
Speak to me.
Won't you speak to me?
Speak, Lord.
I was so
he won't leave you. He won't leave you. He will not forsake you for sure. You can bank on it. You can set your clock to Christ not leaving you ever. Mm-hmm. What's your smart word? 1984 on the Psalms Project.
Great album.
That's an amazing album. Dottie Jones, right?
Yeah, Dottie Jones.
Yeah. Boy. Listen, I think I've got the phone caller. I hope it's Shamika Wilson calling in about the Black Empowerment Summit. Hey, Shamika, is that you?
Yes, sir. How you doing, Minister?
I'm so good. It's so good to have you on the show again.
Again. Oh, my God. It's a long time since we spoke.
Yes.
But we have corresponded on Facebook and everything, so I miss your voice. I miss you.
I like how you say that. That's just so sweet. You're gonna make me dig in my pocket and send you something through PayPal. Yeah. Hey, what's going on? You got some type of empowerment going on.
Yes, sir. I have been, God has really been placed things on my heart to help our people. And when I say our people, the Black race, and also just people that are in need. You know, the Bible says you give, you shall receive. You know, the Bible says you help give water, give food, give clothing. You do it to him. And I just got a heart for my people, for our community, for those in need, beyond race and color. But at this time, God gave me an idea to do a Black Empowerment Summit.
Mm-hmm.
And this is Black history, but it's not just because it's Black history. Because, I hear everybody say Black. I heard Annette on the show, actually.
Sure.
She said that every day. I think she said, or her guest said, that every day is Black history, which is so true. I agree. Every day is Black history.
Mm-hmm.
And what we're doing is we're going to get together at Dan Soul Food and Bakery this Saturday, February 6th. At between 2 to 5 p.m., and we're going to have a guest speaker, and who is Brandon Skates, and he is a very intelligent young man, and he talks about empowering and educating the people, our Black race, about our history, about where we come from, how can we improve our communities, how can we improve ourselves, our families, and everything. So he's an awesome speaker. We also will have other guests from community activists, business leaders, musicians, comedians, clergy, all people from all kinds of work, walks of life will be present. And we're coming together just to speak about, first of all, to come together. We have a lot of division going on in our community.
Mm.
So first of all, I want to bring people together. And, love brings people together. So when we come together, we're going to love on each other. And we're going to talk about different topics that's going on in our community. And the reason, and a lot of the things that's going on in our community is because we don't love each other.
Right.
So we're going to talk about the issues such as violence, public school issues in the Black community, the mass incarceration of nonviolent drug offenders, mm-hmm. unemployment in our community, the need for Black-owned businesses as well as jobs and good trades and things like that. We're going to try to recognize different business owners that are Black. If business owners or are you a musician, whatever kind of hustle, let's say hustle for right now, whatever hustle you got going on with the business, if it's music, if it's entertainment, whatever it is, we're going to put you on the spotlight and you have your opportunity right then and there to just tell us of what you're doing. And and it's about supporting each other. I know, a lot of people don't support each other, and it's time for us to stop that and once again get back to love and support each other.
Right.
And also, we're going to collect water for Flint residents, so Flint, Michigan residents.
Hmm.
So we're asking people to bring water bottles, water jugs, and water filters. And we're going to connect with our organization so we can bring them water. So,
awesome.
Yeah.
Wow.
All that in one breath.
Yeah, you did that great. Absolutely wonderful job. And this is what you do all the time anyway. I'm not surprised that you're even doing this. I was a part of a couple of things you've done so far.
Yes, I know. I love you.
Oh, I love you too. Come on, are we a team? I told you that day one.
Yeah, you should
do. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I don't take my words back now. Don't cross me. Okay, but Black Empowerment Summit tomorrow. Not tomorrow, Saturday from 2 to 5, right?
Yes, sir.
2 to 5. Okay, please meet us there. I know, you know, it's Saturday. Y'all got a lot going on, but hopefully you got something going on to empower you, you black people. So why don't you go there? If you want to be empowered, don't be empowered at the grocery store at 8 o'clock waiting in line for some chips. Why don't you go over there at 2 o'clock and hear some wonderful speakers, and you expose yourself to the people of God who's going to show up at this event. What's the address again?
Yes, it's Dan Soul Food and Bakery,
mm-hmm.
2523 West 79th Street. That's two blocks west of Western on 79th Street.
Hmm. Yeah, Western. Okay, over in the west, southwest. Yeah.
Yeah.
Ain't far. Most of you people who listen to me are Southsiders anyway. So
just
go walk up the street and there you are. You're there.
Mm-hmm.
All right. All right.
Take a bus, too.
Yeah, take a bus if you have to. And those of you who live in New York and listen to me, well, you know, they do have two airports there, don't they?
Yeah, they do.
Yeah, LaGuardia and Kennedy, is it again? Yeah, those two. Mm-hmm. Yeah, take one of those.
One more thing, Minister. This is going to be televised, just to let people know that.
Awesome.
Just to be aware, it's going to be taped for CAN TV program.
Oh, see, now Jesse Jackson is going to show up.
Calm your head.
Okay, here comes.
Yeah, oh, Jesus.
Uh-oh, here Jesse, he coming.
Don't be messing with Jesse like that.
Al Sharpton going to show up, too. Watch, they coming. They coming now. They know them
cameras.
Them cameras gonna be
don't
there.
Chris Harris.
Oh, Chris gonna be there, and Pastor Brooks gonna be there.
Yeah,
you gonna have some people
swarming
to your
Holmes,
station.
Yeah, Holmes. Yes. Ira, I agree. He'll be there.
Yeah, Ira Joe. Yeah.
They gonna be. All right. Let me stop.
Hey, Shamika.
Hey, who's this?
Annette.
Oh my goodness. You guys are my sisters and brothers.
She makes me cry all the time.
I love you, girl.
Oh,
doing wonderful. You keep up the good work, okay?
Thank you.
All right.
Can y'all do that on your own dime?
Yeah, I mean.
You know what I'm saying? Y'all call each other tonight sometime and just love on each other on AT&T. Who your provider?
Don't worry
Boost
about
Mobile?
That. Don't worry about
you
that.
Call Cricket.
We already talked today, so we're talking again.
What's that? Some extension of.
What's that Walmart?
Track.
Track.
Get your track.
Anyway,
okay.
Empower them, please. Thank you.
All right, Shamika, Saturday, 2 o'clock. Y'all show up, please, even if I can't because there's so much going on. But you know I got your back, so regardless.
I know.
Okay.
You let me have this platform. I appreciate it. That's more than enough. Thank you.
All right, sweetheart. Love you, dear.
Okay, love y'all. See ya.
Okay,
love
see
you.
Ya.
Bye-bye.
All right, y'all, let's get back to this. We'll do another announcement around 5:30. Or before we get off the air, because I do want to announce, so those of you who got some students, some kids out there, you need to do something with them as far as their learning is concerned. I got an announcement to make for you as well. But I want to get back to Jude because the people are waiting for me to continue. All right, what verse did we end off on, please?
Well, I only ended verse 7 in Uh-oh. Jude.
Here we go.
Verse 8, in the same way, these people who claim authority from their dreams live immoral lives,
mm-hmm.
defy authority, and scoff at supernatural beings.
Scoff at it.
Mm-hmm.
Scoffers.
But even Michael, one of the mightiest of the angels, did not dare accuse the devil of blasphemy.
Even Michael, the archangel. Uh-huh. He was contending with the devil of disputing the body of Moses, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What did he say?
But simply said,
uh-huh.
The Lord rebuke you.
Oh, my goodness. Notice Michael, he didn't say, I rebuke you.
The Lord
rebuke you.
I can't rebuke him.
I can't rebuke. Y'all out there talking about him, I rebuke you, devil. The devil was like, I rebuke you, too.
Yeah.
You ain't got no power.
I can beat
rebuke
you.
Rebuke me.
William, give me a close.
Yeah, except you rebuking through the Holy Spirit.
You look like a son of Siva.
You ain't rebuking nothing. Mm-mm. The Lord rebuke you. Even the angel, the archangel, understood that. Okay, what did it say?
This took place when Michael was arguing with the devil about Moses.
They were arguing. Don't please the devil, y'all. We argue with the devil all the time. But notice that the devil he argued with him about something very important. See, the mm-hmm. devil's going to argue with you with God on something valuable mm-hmm. to you, mm-hmm. that which is something valuable to God as well.
Right.
Something that you did. Satan was there. He saw you do it. Mm-hmm. Because Moses killed a man, buried him in the sand. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so the devil was arguing with Archangel because Michael buried him. Mm-hmm. And the Satan was like, you're not supposed to do that. And Moses wasn't worthy of it. You're like, where you get all that from, bro, Jones? All right, let's cross-reference. Mm-hmm. Let's go to Exodus 2, 11.
Exodus 2 and 11.
Yeah.
Many years later, when Moses had grown up, he went out to visit his own people, mm-hmm. the Hebrews, and he saw how hard they were forced to work. Mm-hmm. During his visit, he saw an Egyptian beating one of his fellow Hebrews. Mm. After looking in all directions to make sure no one was watching, uh-huh. Moses killed the Egyptian Ooh. And hid the body in the sand.
Ooh, I'm telling. You see what I'm saying? Now, watch this. Go to Deuteronomy 34 and 5 and read 5 and 6.
So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, mm-hmm. just as the Lord had said. Mm-hmm. The Lord buried him in a valley near Bethel.
Who buried him?
The Lord.
Okay.
Now that's a small Lord in NLT.
Uh-huh.
Small L.
Makes suggesting you, that uh-huh. Moses was a Lord or a leader versus God the Lord. Mm-mm. 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 With this lowercase Lord.
No, but it wasn't referring to Moses.
Right.
The Lord buried Moses, is what you're saying.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. But that's a good point, what you're saying, though.
Okay.
Because as far as the capitalizing of. And when the whole L-O-R-D is capitalized.
Mm-hmm. It's no question about who we're talking
yes,
about.
Yes. Okay. Continue.
The Lord buried him in a valley near Bethpor mm-hmm. in Moab. But to this day, no one knows the exact place.
You see what I'm saying? And so Satan is fussing with Michael about this. Mm-hmm. You know, Satan is really, is
he's starting something.
Yeah. And he's dumber than y'all think he is. Y'all think he's the most intelligent being on the world. He's only intelligent because he saw what you did. He can't read our minds. Mm-hmm. Now, five people just shut off their apps. They're like, I don't want to listen to the show no more. I'm going to speak
just
in tongues.
Five.
You know what I'm saying? Just five. Okay, seven. They're like, Satan can read your mind because that's why I speak in tongues, to confuse Satan. Really? Satan know your tongues?
Even if you're speaking in that quote-unquote unknown tongues, he know your intentions.
He know, you know what I'm saying? He know your tongue.
Because you can communicate it with him.
Boy, six more people just shut off the phone. I'm telling you, he
not
is.
Not through the tongues. I ain't suggesting that. What I'm saying is that the battle, the conversations, the inward thoughts between yes. you and him
yes.
have taken place.
Satan is multilingual.
And he's suggestive.
He know all the languages of the earth, every single last one of them. He's the prince of the power of the air. He knows all the languages.
Not all.
Which one he don't know? Stop! Okay, all right, continue. Where we at?
I don't even know. You want me to continue in Deuteronomy?
No. We're done with Deuteronomy. That was Moses' burial was divinely given. Okay. All right. Nine. That's using nine.
Back to Jude.
Uh-huh. Go to 10, I guess. That boy, that
but
darn
even
Alvin.
Michael,
uh-huh.
one of the mightiest of the angels, mm-hmm. did not dare accuse the devil of blasphemy.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord. But simply said, the Lord rebuke you. Mm-hmm. This took place when Michael was arguing with the devil about Moses' body. Mm-hmm. But these people scoff at things they do not understand.
That's what people do in church.
Like unthinking animals.
Mm-hmm. Unthinking animals.
They do whatever their instincts tell them.
Unthinking animals. Yeah.
And so they bring about their own destruction.
Destroy yourself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What sorrow awaits them?
Where you at?
Verse 11.
All right. Woe unto you. Uh-huh.
For they follow in the footsteps of Cain, who killed his brother.
Man, who was that? Christ was talking to the Pharisees. Mm-hmm. He says, you are like, what do you say? You are like your father, the devil who was a murderer in the beginning, I think he said. Mm-hmm. And he was talking about Cain when he was rebuking the Pharisees. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Like Balaam, they deceive people for money.
Balaam was offered money to curse Israel. after God forbade the curse, Balaam enticed Israel to sin. Matter of fact, again, we keep referencing Peter. I think that's in Peter. Matter of fact, King James said in a funny way, makes people laugh sometimes. But it, matter of fact, let's go there because sometimes I use this in church and I have to say, okay, Walter, some people don't get the joke. Let's see which one I'm at. La-da-dee. Okay, go to 2 Peter mm-hmm. chapter 2 mm-hmm. and 16. But you have to do it in King James, though. Because NLT, it ain't going to be funny in NLT.
What's so funny?
Second Peter 2 and 16. You got it?
You see what I'm saying?
You see what I'm saying?
He can read that.
But was rebuked for his iniquity.
Okay, go to 15 then. Next.
Okay. Yeah, I thought about it.
Second Peter is filled with those kind of.
Yes, it is.
Man. Okay.
Yeah.
Which have forsaken the right way, are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, mm-hmm. who loved the wages of unrighteousness,
yeah,
but was rebuked for his iniquity.
What do you do?
The dumbass, speaking with man's voice, forbade the madness of the prophet.
Yes.
These are...
You see what I'm saying? The dumbass speaking with the man's voice. Some of these false prophets.
But you got to give clarity to what that means. Come on. You can't leave it like that, man.
I have to.
You can't.
Many of these false prophets are dumbass.
Yeah, but this is talking about a real donkey, man. Come on. This is talking about a real beast of burden.
Many of these false prophets are beasts of burden.
Yeah, they burden on people, yes. But.
Go ahead, man.
Oh, my goodness.
All right. Where we at?
These are the wells without water, clouds that are carried with a tempest, to whom the midst of the darkness is reserved forever.
Oh, boy.
For they speak of great swelling of words, vanity. They are lured through the lust of the flesh.
Yes.
Through much wantonness.
Wantonness. You know what? I love that soup.
Oh, I just had some last night. Wonton soup is good.
Yes. Good stuff.
Those that are clean escape from them who live mm-hmm. in error.
Yes.
While they promise them liberty, they themselves are servants of corruption. For whom a man is overthrown.
Servants.
Yes. They are servants of corruption. Hence, preachers of Atlanta. Flint, Michigan.
It's coming, Doc. Yeah. It's coming. I'm going to turn this water
to
wine.
Yeah.
I'm
going
to turn this.
Oh, God. He's dying.
My goodness. Now, again, you know, there's a lot of miracle workers out there proclaimed.
Okay.
Not a one of them went down to Flint, Michigan and put their finger in the water.
Wait.
And turned the lead to appear.
You just bring up a point. Mm-hmm. One of our friends posted that a preacher asked the preacher for prayer. Mm-hmm. And he said, I need you to pray for me for my hearing. It's coming up. My hearing. Uh-huh. The man stopped and let him finish. Laid hands on him, prayed for him, said, how's your hearing now? He said, I don't know. It's next Tuesday.
They know there's some dumb people out there. They may not understand what you're saying.
He was talking
D-O-M, dumb. Get it. What?
He was talking about a court hearing, not necessarily his auditory ability.
Why? Jesus, that's so funny.
Guess who posted that?
Who?
Ed Charles.
Did he?
That's what makes it all the more funny.
That's funny. That's hilarious. Okay.
Yeah, man. That's real funny.
Where we at?
We're still in Peter? Or you want to go back to Jude?
Jude. Jude. Okay. I hear you.
I was reading verse 11.
Okay.
What sorrow awaits them, for they follow in the footsteps of Cain, who killed his brother. Like Balaam, they deceive people for money, and like Korah, they perish in their rebellion. Mm-hmm. When these people eat with you in your fellowship meals commemorating the Lord's love, they are like dangerous reefs that can shipwreck you.
Wow.
They are like shameless.
Have you
shepherds?
Ever seen the reefs in the water?
Yes.
It catches sometimes to catch a boat.
Clogs can't up even the rudder.
Clogs up.
Mm-hmm. It just snares them.
Yes.
It's like,
woo,
tangled up,
tied up, tangled up. Mm-hmm.
And you sinking.
Yes. Uh huh.
They are like shameless shepherds who care only for themselves.
Wow.
They are like clouds blowing over the land without giving any rain.
Have you ever seen that? Mm-hmm. I'm sure you have. Have you ever seen a dark cloud that has no moisture in it? That's what they're saying here.
That's fog.
Man, that's all it is. It's just fog. Huh?
They are like trees in autumn that are doubly dead, for they bear no fruit.
What the cloud represents over the land is, if you are an agriculture man, if you're a farmer, seeing a cloud is a sign of rain, a positive. It's an encouraging thing. Meaning, that means eventually, hopefully, that cloud's going to get darker and the moisture is going to spill over.
Release.
It's going to be a release. These false prophets, they are hovering over you, giving you hope that there's going to be a release. And then when they get in these churches, they always say, this is your year of increase. This is your time. There's going to release in the atmosphere. They're using those words. Come on, man. That's what this is saying right here. So poetic, but yet so in your face. Uh-huh. What does it say here?
For they bear no fruit.
No fruit.
And have been pulled Jesus up cursed by the tree. Roots.
And pulled it up by the roots, because you got to pull it from so it won't grow again. Don't. Y'all say chop it off at the head. No, chop it off at the root.
That's right.
Because the roots continue to grow.
Yes, sir.
You have to almost dig up the stump, because you can cut it off at the base, and the roots continue to grow on the ground and tangle up.
Yeah, yeah.
Get all in your pipes, cause basement flood.
Come on, man. Uh-huh. What's that?
They are like waves of the sea, churning up the foam of their shameful deeds. Mm. They are like wandering stars, doomed forever to black darkness.
Black hole.
Enoch, who lived in the seventh generation after Adam.
We just read that in Genesis.
Prophesied about these people.
Now he's talking, because he wasn't talking in Genesis, because we never heard him speak anything. He didn't say nothing. He just was with God and then he gone. Okay, but now he's talking. What did he say?
He said, listen.
Check this out.
The Lord is coming with countless thousands of his holy ones.
A whole lot of them.
To execute judgment on the people of the world.
Yeah.
He will convict every person of all the ungodly things they have done.
Every one of them.
And for all the insults that ungodly sinners have spoken against him.
Insults that they've spoken against God. You can curse God all you want to. And insult him all you want to. He remembers.
Oh, God. Yeah, wouldn't you?
Yeah. I will remember. Mm. Yeah. Your labor will not be in vain.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's
Ronald Wilands and the family.
That's right. That's it. That's a song right there. Uh-huh. What did it say?
Verse 16. Mm-hmm. These people are grumblers and complainers.
Grumblers. Uh-huh.
Living only to satisfy their desires.
Yeah.
They brag loudly about themselves.
Look what I did. Look who I blessed, Sister So-and-so. I paid her rent. I can't wait to get you to tell it.
And they flatter others to get what they want.
Yeah, they flatter you to get whatever they want. I've seen this among the body of Christ. I've seen this too many times. Okay.
But you, my dear friends, must remember what the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ predicted.
All these apostles. Okay, y'all know all of them. It's about 12 of them.
They told you.
What?
That in the last times there would be scoffers whose purpose in life is to satisfy their ungodly desires.
In the last times, in the last days. That's right now. It was then too, and it's still now. Uh-huh.
These people are the ones who are creating divisions among you.
Uh-huh.
They follow their natural instincts because they do not have God's spirit in them.
Okay.
But you, dear friends, must build each other up in your most holy faith. Yeah. Pray in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Okay, stop. All right.
I ain't touching it.
Yeah.
I'm not touching that one.
I know you're not. I don't want to touch it, but I have to touch it. Okay, I have to touch it. Go to Romans 8:15, please.
Ooh. Oh, God.
I know. Verse 20 says, but ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Okay. And you have to, it's a pause. It's a comma there. But I have to stop there so that we can elaborate just a little bit. All right. What's it say? Romans 8:15.
So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves.
Yeah.
Instead, you received God's Spirit when He adopted you as His own children.
Okay, you received the Spirit once He adopted you as His children. Right now, the Spirit, you have the Spirit now. What do you do with this Spirit? Okay, mm-hmm. The Apostle Paul is telling us what the Spirit does for us. Mm-hmm. We don't ask for gifts. God gives us gifts. The Spirit gives us gifts as He will.
As He will.
It's His choice.
You aspire, but it ain't yours.
It ain't yours.
To give or go get.
I want to be a teacher. I want to be this great. No. The Spirit may not want you to be that. He may want you to just be evangelist. Okay.
Like that boy talking about, I want to sing soprano. He's mm-hmm. a baritone.
You see what I'm saying? Okay. All right. So, once it says, such praying includes praying in one's own language as prompted by the Spirit. Your own language, so I can pray. I can pray in English uh-huh. and still be praying in the Holy Ghost.
Yeah, because God could give you what to pray for me.
You see what I'm saying,
man? How you know that? That's mm-hmm. exactly what I'm going through
I'm
right now.
I'm praying in English, and I'm still praying in the Holy Ghost. I'm talking to you, deep people out there.
Yeah.
If I go over to a foreign land and they don't know a lick of English, and I start praying, I'm praying in tongues because those people over there don't know English and they don't know what I'm saying.
Hello.
I just, 9 people just shut off the air. Okay. Y'all getting too deep and y'all so caught up in these tongues till it's causing the false teachers to come in and fool y'all, because as soon as you hear a tongue, you think it's from God.
You better recognize it.
If you don't recognize it, y'all, he gonna turn it. Come on, it's a Jim Jones spirit happening in this world. Mm-hmm. Then praying with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now, y'all think that's what you think it is. Go to Romans 8:26. What does that say?
And the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness.
In our weakness. Okay, what happens?
For example,
uh-huh.
we don't know what God wants us to pray for.
And a lot of times, I just don't know what to say. Uh-huh.
But the Holy Spirit prays for us.
Wait. It didn't say I pray. What did it say?
The Holy Ghost.
What?
Holy Spirit, excuse me, prays for us.
The Holy Spirit prays for us.
Uh-huh. With groanings.
Okay, notice I'm not groaning. The Holy Spirit says it's praying.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh, groanings.
They cannot be expressed in mm-hmm. words.
You see what I'm saying? The Holy Spirit is groaning, and it is not expressive in words. Yes.
And the Father, who knows mm-hmm. all hearts,
yeah.
knows what the Spirit is saying.
Uh-huh.
For the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's okay. own will.
So I don't know what to say. So y'all thinking that I'm going to just speak in some type of murmur. You got to be contextual. Just got to be careful. The old teachers taught this, but they didn't understand. They didn't understand this King James type of language. So they told you, speak in your heavenly language, speak in a tongue. And y'all went to go on with whatever, gibberish or what have you. Mm-hmm. And you thinking, oh, that's the Holy Spirit groaning. No, that's you just gibbering. You don't even know what the Holy Spirit is saying, okay? The groans. Now, what the Bible does say, he calls out on the wailing women and mm-hmm. howling women, mm-hmm. okay? So there is a fervor of a deep passion to go before the Lord. And you hear I've heard it in church all my life, the crying out and the wailing and the screaming. God actually approves of that. He says he warned that from the Israelites, the Israelite women especially, okay? And then you have to go to 1 Corinthians 14:4, all right? Go there. Then it says, and praying in a tongue unknown to the one praying. All right, now here comes the tongue, because people out there just try to interpret me saying I'm against speaking in tongues.
1 Corinthians 14:4. A person who speaks in tongues mm-hmm. is strengthened personally.
Okay.
But one who speaks a word of prophecy strengthens mm-hmm. the entire church.
God's the apostle is saying the prophecy is worth more than any tongue you can speak. Okay. Uh-huh. That was 4?
Yes.
And then 14 says what?
4, if I pray in tongues,
yeah.
my spirit is praying.
Uh-huh.
But I don't understand what I'm saying.
I don't know what I'm saying. Tongues, not gibberish, not noise. I'm speaking, but I don't know what I'm saying. Here's where the tongues is applied.
Mm-hmm.
So I gave you 3 areas because I want to leave y'all on the, what's that thing on the boat that the pirates always make you walk. I put y'all, made y'all walk the plank with me, get upset with me until I take you to this place where it's more familiar with you people who speak in tongues. All right, I got you now. So y'all thought I wasn't going to go there. Here's where it applies here. So there is, so to help us understand 20, praying in the Holy Ghost, there are different ways of doing it.
And you can't dismiss it.
You cannot dismiss it, no. And I can't judge you on how you pray in tongues. Let me pray in my way. I'm talking about praying in the Holy Ghost, my bad. I can't judge you how you pray in the Holy Ghost. I pray my way, you pray your way. I just gave you three ways of doing it. And if you pray in, and if everybody in church say, somebody say, everybody speak in tongues, I'm going to start praying in English. I do it all the time. And some people look at me like, but he's not speaking in tongues. Yes, I am.
Tongues are for the weak at
faith. I'm speaking in my tongue.
Even still, Paul suggests further on in the text that it's for those that are weak in faith or unbelievers. But if you're mature, you don't need those tongues.
The people who are believers in that church, the tongues were not for them, like you just said. I'm just interpreting what he just said. Paul specifically said the unbeliever walks in and hear this the tongue, and he believes. So he says speaking in tongues is not for the believer. It's for the unbeliever. Not for the unbeliever to speak it, but for us to speak it so the unbeliever can understand that, wait a minute, how he's speaking in my language? How does he know this? That's the only interpretation of that scripture, because if I'm speaking in a language that he doesn't understand, as tongues, he's even more confused. So apparently my tongue must be something that he understands.
Whether no one else does or not.
Yep. He understands.
Because it sounds like something different to everybody else.
You see what I'm saying? But him. So how else could you interpret that scripture except this man, if he's going to believe?
That's Navajo code.
Come on, man.
Now, I make that reference because in World War II, they had a hard time discerning spies. So they had hired a Navajo Indian. And he communicated. He taught some Navajo language, which the Japanese and the other Europeans had never heard.
Right.
Had no reference.
Mm-hmm.
And he would communicate messages across the sea in Navajo. And only another person who understood Navajo could get the message. And it avoids spies from interpreting a message. So sometimes tongues can have that same purpose. I want nobody else to understand nothing that's being said between you, me, and God.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, you don't even need to know.
Yeah. There you go. See, you went there.
Pink car.
Remember that pig language we used to do when we were children?
Pig Latin.
That's what it is. Okay.
Yeah. But a pink car may have no significance to either one of us.
That's right.
But that person, it has a ton of significance.
Absolutely. 21, please.
Of Jude.
Well, you have back to Jude? You have to, Jude. So you have to now read it in context now. Start at 20 again and then read it fully.
Okay.
I ain't got no pages. I got to keep hitting buttons going back.
I know.
But you, dear friends, must build each other up in your most holy faith, pray in the power of the Holy Spirit, and await the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will bring you eternal life.
Keep yourself in the love of God, looking for the mercy of Lord Jesus Christ.
In this way.
Now, this is great. I love this. Some what?
You will keep yourselves safe in God's love. And you must show mercy to those whose faith is wavering.
Some have compassion, making a difference. That's what King James says. All right. Some of you, like me, when I win someone to the Lord, I'm full of compassion. And some people, you look at my meekness as being weak, but I win a lot of people through that. I'm not combative with them.
Right.
I'm not harsh with them. I'm not a fire and brimstone preacher. That's not me. I'm more calm like this, and I win a lot of people. And I've changed the minds of many atheists. I've made them really think, okay?
And you say you're not an evangelist.
No, I'm not. You just that in my calling.
Okay.
Because we all have done all these things in the fivefold.
Okay.
But that doesn't mean that's our office. My office is teacher.
You ain't in an office. You in a room right now.
Shut up. Okay, and then what?
Rescue others by snatching them from the flames of judgment.
Now, here's the fire and brimstone preacher. He is needed.
Oh, yeah.
Earl Carter was his type of preaching is needed. Fire and brimstone.
Yeah.
He just needs to be taught like Apollos was when he was introduced to Aquila and Priscilla.
He should not get caught up in the sensationalism.
The sensationalism, yes.
He got sensationalized when he went that deep.
Yes, absolutely.
He lost the compassion when he said that line.
He lost compassion and he find joy almost. Matter of fact, we have to do that real quick because I know I got that announcement. Let's go there. Proverbs 24:15 maybe. Proverbs 24:15 and keep reading.
Don't wait in ambush at the home of the godly.
Okay. Don't read that yet because what happens is it shows up in Jude. Stay there. I'm going to keep reading and have some compassion making a difference. And Jude continues, says, and others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garments spotted by the flesh. All right. Pull them out. A fireman sees the house on fire. First of all, we're not going to ignore it. Even if he's not on duty. Okay. Notice that. Even when he's not on duty.
He's still.
There's something in him. His training, his compassion for that job makes him stop every time. I know some pastors who wear the clergy in church and that's the only time they work. But Monday through Saturday, they're not even smart enough to be a fire person. They see people falling in hell. And they walk right by the burning bush, the burning house. Your house on fire? Okay, I'm going to go over here and call somebody, see if they can come get you. But let me stop off at the clinic first, at the deli or at McDonald's. And then when I'm done, I'll call for help. Okay, fireman ain't going to do that. He going to run in that burning building.
It's innate.
It's in him. Okay, all right. Then 24 says, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling. All right, then read what you got there.
Don't wait in ambush at the home of the godly, and don't raid the house where the godly live. Mm-hmm. The godly may trip seven times.
A just man falls seven times. Okay.
And get back up again.
Uh-huh. What did it say?
But they will get up again.
But the man keep falling. But notice God called him just. That seems out of order, don't it?
Not to me.
Not to me either.
It's the getting up that makes him just.
She's what I'm saying. Boy, you just said something right there. Uh-huh.
Wow.
Uh-huh.
He's pretty deep, Alvin.
Come on now.
But one disaster is
enough. See, we a team. We bounce off each other.
To overthrow the wicked.
Did I say that? Scratch that. Okay, what is it?
But one disaster is enough to overthrow the wicked.
One disaster. Uh-huh.
Don't rejoice when your enemies fall.
There it is. Don't get happy and rejoice when your enemies fall.
Oh.
Don't. Rejoice in the streets when your enemy falls into destruction.
Where is your compassion?
Where is your compassion? Because that still could be you. There's people I know some men who shot somebody, murdered somebody, what have you, and they go in jail. Everybody's rejoicing. Finally, he in jail, rotting, burned in hell. I said, really? Are you a Christian? This could be you.
Right.
Don't rejoice. That man's his body is lost. Now, his soul may not be lost. Because he could, most of the cats
they find Jesus
in jail,
yeah.
But they're gone now. You won't see them again. Not in the free world. Don't rejoice over that. Okay, what does it say?
Don't be happy when they stumble.
Don't be happy.
For the Lord will be displeased with you, mm-hmm. and will turn His anger away from them.
Uh huh. This is Earl Carter. He's excited.
Ooh.
He keeps calling out Bishop Blake, even calling him girl names.
Oh no,
Charlene. He calls him.
He didn't stop. I thought he
didn't stop. No, this is a new video. Just came out yesterday. He called him Charlene.
Lord.
Yeah, and he said, you can see the happiness of him exposing people who think he's done
that
these
means
things.
He has a hurt spirit now.
Yeah, he's a man who's scorned.
Oh,
okay,
all
right?
Jesus.
Yeah, okay, go back to Jude and finish this ball game so I get out of here.
Okay.
Now to him that's able to keep you from falling to present you faultless. Now he, God, Christ, presents you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. All right.
He's excited about that. Come on, be my daddy. Come on.
You
come on, be my daddy. Let me take you to my daddy.
There you go. So when we pray.
If you do all this I told you, let me tell you. Let me show you my daddy.
That's it. When we pray to God, God looks at his son. He ain't looking at us. He look at his son. He says, is he worthy? Yeah, well, look at my hands, God. Dad, look at my side. Okay.
Ain't he red?
Yeah, ain't you? See what I'm saying?
He smeared all my blood. Look at the doorpost of his forehead.
Yeah. I like what Ephesians 3 says, 3:19, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with the fullness of God
passes knowledge.
Passes it.
Yes.
Now to him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly.
No, read that again.
Exceeding abundantly.
There you go.
I know there's we had that problem before.
Yes,
above all that we ask or that's think.
More than too much.
Yep. It's above abundantly is what that's saying.
Yeah, too much.
It's
more
exceeding.
Than too much. It's past uh-huh. too much.
Mm-hmm. All we can ask or think according to the power that work. Now there must be an accordance.
Yeah,
it's according to something.
Well, it's always conditioned.
There you go.
You just can't claim or proclaim mm-hmm. anything just because you got a mouth to say or you heard it. It's got to be according to his will. It's got to be according to him. Just because you can go to the store and buy the collar ooh. Don't mean you got the right to wear the collar.
Then come on, man. Stop
just
it.
Because you, oh, sorry, okay.
You're preaching. I can't stand it. I can't stand it. To the only wise God our Savior. This is Jude again.
Yeah.
To the only wise
only
God our
wise
Savior.
God.
Be glory and majesty.
Got other gods that ain't wise.
Dominion and power. Both now and forever. What's the last word
both
in there?
Now and ever.
Amen.
Now and forever. You can spend 2 hours.
Doesn't it say and ever?
Now and forever.
Now and forever.
Doesn't it say ever?
No, you looking in the new version.
No, look in King James.
Now yeah. and ever.
Mm-hmm.
Ever.
Yeah, now and ever, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So we can put 4 there too.
Yeah, that's apples and oranges right there.
Yeah. Now and ever.
Yes. Jared Halliburton says that the falling angels were able to produce semen to impregnate women.
Ooh.
And that's a question she's asking. Those falling angelic spirits became flesh. I don't know if the question is she asked a question or she's being
rhetorical.
Yeah, I don't know.
Did okay. they need semen?
Right.
Or did they just need seed?
You see what I'm saying?
It's two different things.
And I'm telling you, it's not written. So we all of us going to guess at it. D. Monet is saying, stay right there. I'm calling in. No, we about to end the show, bro. Folks speaking gibberish and confused. That's what he's saying. Hey, got an announcement here. What you got there?
I have Rescue Missionary Center Church and School.
Rescue Missionary Church. Yes.
It looks like their theme is Shining the Light for Our Youth.
Shining the light on heaven for...
Mm-hmm.
They are actually, they have an open house coming up. And just a little bit of background about them. They have been providing over 34 years of excellence in Christian education.
That's a long time.
It is.
Many schools start and they close, especially Christian schools,
mm-hmm.
especially African-American Christian schools.
Yes.
They've been going strong that yes. long in that one location.
Mm-hmm.
That's a feat.
Okay.
That should be praised.
Yes. Uh-huh. The grades are pre-kindergarten through 8th grade.
Yeah.
Let's see. Their open house is coming up. They have a free registration on Thursday, March 17th at 7 o'clock p.m.
Mm.
But you must RSVP by March 10th, 2016.
Mm-hmm.
The address, 7740 South Eberhardt. And this is the former St. Dorothy School.
Mm-hmm. Those of you who live in Chicago, yes.
Of course, it's in Chicago, Illinois.
Uh-huh.
Their number is 773-224-0439.
What is it?
773-224-0439.
Mm-hmm.
They also have a email, I'm sorry, rescuethem@sbcglobal.net.
Hmm.
Rescuethem@sbcglobal.net.
I love that.
And you can also like them on Facebook. And then they also have a website, greatschools.net.
So what are the ages? Is it an age there?
I indicated that, pre-kindergarten through 8th grade.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Y'all got some kids out there. You said, okay, it's time. You're in turn 8. You're in turn 8th grade.
Okay.
Okay. It's time for you to go somewhere
yes.
and go somewhere where you can get the teachings of wonderful teaching of Jesus Christ, our Savior, and many of the secular practicalities that we need to live thereby,
mm-hmm.
live a visible life on this earth. And that's what that school does.
Yes.
All right. And so rewind Spreaker. If you want that information again, just rewind this show and you'll be able to hear the phone number again and the address and everything. March. All right.
So March 17th is the free registration.
That's another month.
Mm-hmm.
So you got some time. Please, please do that. We'll be announcing it again over and over again.
Yes.
Okay. Hey, Alvin.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hey, man, can I? I'm going to do something.
Uh-oh.
I'm going to do something here.
Uh-oh.
Hey, Brittany, we've done this maybe once or twice in the history of the Sir Walter Jones Show. I'm going to do a controversial corner on the spot.
Oh, my God.
I'm going to do it. He going to do it. Go ahead and play his opening.
Oh, Jesus.
And he gonna do a controversial corner on, the Bible said, be y'all so ready. On
do
Jude.
It, baby.
Oh, Jude. Everything we talked about. Yep.
Oh,
okay.
Lord.
Pick one and go for it. Hey, go ahead, play that intro.
Politics. Doctrine. Current events. Let's meet at the controversy corner on the Sir Walter Jones Show. Here on UBM Praise.
Controversy. Can't understand.
This is Keep It Real Card here at the intersection of controversy and contention. We've been studying the Book of Jude, and the Book of Jude is a short book, one of the smallest epistles ever written, but it's so concise and filled with content that you can live by. It deals with everything from majesty to manners, from legalism to love. So I got a few points I want to bring out in this book. Number one, how you behave before mankind will determine how mankind behaves before God. I say that because your life is a walking billboard. If you say you believe God and believe the Bible, you should be a living epistle. Your life may be the only Bible some people may read. Next point, how you understand and interpret what the Word of God means will determine and govern how you present yourself before God. If you don't know what God is expecting, and then how do you know what to expect from God? If you don't know what God is expecting of you, then how do you know what to expect from other believers? And my last point, Jude deals with how we are presented to God beyond our own power and ability, but by God's choice and God's intervention. I love how he closes out with, now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the only wise God and Savior, both majesty, both now and ever. Amen. In other words, regardless of how you behave, regardless of how you misinterpret, regardless of how you mess up, Jesus is always there to clean you up, cover you with his blood, and proudly and boldly present you to God. And says, I know you done messed up. I know you done jacked up. But I'm with you both now and ever. Amen. That's my controversial corner for today.
Controversial corner on the spot. Yeah. Usually at 5:30, but we can't get him on here.
My God. That's I what thought I got away.
I couldn't get away, Doc.
Man, I didn't write a away. Note or nothing. I was like, oh, it's 5:30. I'm good.
Get my outro in there, Britt.
Who else wrong?
Man, I love it, man. See, that's what I said. I chose this man specifically. I believe the Lord himself had me to choose this man for this show.
I remember that day. It was a Sunday afternoon at exactly 12:44.
Ain't that something?
I was driving eastbound on Interstate 88, leaving Aurora.
Wow. Wow. Ain't that something? And he just linked us. I thought we were just joking with each other, and then the Spirit said, no, he's the man.
Wow.
Yeah, he is the man who I am well pleased. Yeah.
Glory to God.
We live in a unique time in history, and this little book can help equip us for the untold challenges of living in the end times. Today's Christian must be on guard for false doctrines, which can easily deceive us if we are not versed in the Word. We need to know the gospel to protect and defend it and accept the Lord Jesus in his Lordship, which is evidence by a life change. Authentic faith always reflects Christ-like behavior. Our life in Christ should reflect our very own heart knowledge that rests on the authority of the Almighty Creator and the Father who puts faith into practice. We need that personal relationship with him. Only then will we know his voice so well that we will follow no other. Hear his voice, y'all. As it speaks in, I think it is the book of John 10:10, the thief comes but to steal, kill, and destroy. That's talking not just to the devil. That's talking to you false teachers out there. Come through the door. Stay off the roof. Sorry, President Barack Obama and Michelle. We ran out of time. We didn't get a chance to interview
you. They're in the waiting room, man.
Well, we got to get them tomorrow. Tomorrow's Fireside Friday. We got special guests coming on tomorrow. Don't go nowhere, y'all. It's going to be another hot show. Brittany on the board. Thank you, girl. Get on there to the other job you got going on. I know you're just a busy woman. Mm-hmm. She's the hardest working engineer in America. Thank you, guys. Rewind this show on Spreaker.com and share it with your friends and family. Okay. Love you. And pray for the family of the great Maurice White. Gave us a wonderful music. Mm-hmm. Love you, guys. This is
the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Up.
am God all by myself. I mouth when I make the beginning and the end. If you put your trust in me, I know it gets hard sometimes, but I want you to trust me. And even in the midst of recession,
ladies and gents, if you missed any of today's show, head to Spreaker.com and search the Sir Walter Jones Show and listen to this show and past shows. Now remember, search for the Sir Walter Jones Show on Spreaker.com. That's Spreaker spelled Spreaker.com. And enjoy.
You have been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show, where Sir Walter Jones provides you with a biblical perspective on everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones at his website, www.sirwalterjones.com. Search the Sir Walter Jones Show on Facebook or follow on Twitter at Sir Walter's Music. Until next time, thank you for listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.